Everyone, this is Deanna Minnick, host of the Detox Summit, and today we have a very special guest. His name is Sayer G, and for those of you who don't know Sayer, he's an author, educator, advisory board member of the National Health Federation, the steering committee member of the Global GMO-Free Coalition, and the founder of the world's most widely referenced evidence-based natural health resource of its kind. And that website is greenmedinfo.com, and that was founded in 2008 in order to provide the world an open access, evidence-based resource supporting natural and integrative modalities. You know, Sayer, it's, first of all, welcome. Thanks for being part of the Detox Summit.
It's an honor. Thank you for having me.
You know, I always get questions from people about what are the go-to sites of where they should go for credible, reputable information. And I love your site. I just learned about your site earlier this year, and I'm so pleased to have found it.
Thank you.
So it's quite incredible to pull together all of those resources and to be able to offer that to people. So why don't you tell us a bit, you know, you're doing lots of different things. You mentioned to me that your father's a toxicologist. You're really involved with health. You're really interested in GMOs. I'd like to just hear a little bit more about you as a person and just to hear more about your path. So maybe you can tell us your story.
Well, I believe that I was drawn into, you know, these sorts of topics, natural health and even the issues associated with toxicity because of personal experiences very young. I was rather sickly as an infant, and it was, you know, throughout maybe really most early childhood and then adolescence that I came to experience sort of the dark side of conventional medicine. And yet, you know, through time, I had to go deal with, you know, the sort of the process of accepting as well that I don't know if I was harmed by those things. So, you know, part of my exploration has been trying to identify, you know, really solid evidence of ways that I can heal myself and then also, of course, try to provide those tools to others. So Greenmed Info is really just a sort of a natural consequence of my own personal struggle. Many of us who get into this, it's very much a personal transformative experience that brings us to really wanting to share it with others. And so really that had become my path and mission. Really for the past 10 years, I've really focused on trying to accumulate that research that has helped me and then disseminate it as widely as possible. So
GreenMed Info came about in 2008. So what was the catalyst? What finally brought you to the point of thinking, I need to make a website which gives this information out to people? What was it that was the catalyst?
Well, it was just the fortunate experience of having been introduced to Medline, which is really the National Library of Medicine has this massive sea of data, as you know, and realizing that, you know, I love Google, you know, in the sense of being able to just type into the global brain, you know, a keyword and find almost anything relevant. I mean, it really is remarkable. So really, when you look at the global brain as the internet, Medline is just that convolution in the brain that's dedicated to biomedicine. And all these peer-reviewed and published citations are available, you know, largely through taxpayer money. So it's really something we provide ourselves, but most people don't know about it. So when I saw this ocean of data and spent time like diving in, finding these clinical pearls, you know, many of which are indexed on our site now, I was just amazed that yes, there is so much support for, you know, yoga and for natural medicine and, you know, almost any modality you can think of. There's, I mean, 23 million citations represents approximately 23 million years of scientific labor. So just when you look at the scale of the data and you can just, you know, hone in with the new algorithms available, it just was just so amazing. So I felt like, wow, I need to try to index this. It's there already. And then just, you know, put it out on open access because that's what it's about anyway. You know, it's free data. So,
and you make it in such a way that it's very accessible to the average consumer, right? Because many scientists use PubMed in order to get information, but it's really not for everybody. So you've taken that information and distilled it into these nuggets where people can actually utilize it and understand what people are researching in all of those scientific abstracts.
Yeah, we try, that's for sure. So the core data set is really just these 23,000 abstracts that are indexed across, say, ailments. So you have 3,100 ailments from A to Z. So real simple. And then once they get to, say, diabetes type 2, they can further break down the substances associated from A to Z, or say the problem substances, because as we'll talk about, of course, you know, pesticide exposure has been shown to induce insulin resistance. So it's not just people, you know, being hedonistic and eating too much. I mean, most of us are being poisoned in a way that expresses itself as these diseases. So the idea then definitely is to try to simplify data access so you don't get lost in the sea of data. But we also encourage people to go back to that sea and be aware that it exists as this national treasure house that most people aren't aware of. So part of our mission is actually to pass through us and get back to the free resource just so people know it's there.
That's wonderful. I think it's an incredible resource again. So I'm kind of curious, since you're a purveyor of the literature, and I would call you a literature hound, right? You know, the people that are really with their nose in the virtual books of science. What are some of the trends that you're noticing as it relates to the toxicity of our planet? What are you seeing emerging? What are some of the aspects that people should be aware of that maybe they're not on the pulse of?
Yeah, great question. Well, most people really don't realize that modern medical practice in the drug-based model is actually a form of applied chemistry in ways. Okay, so really what I mean is that you have this massive global petrochemical industrial complex. It's a trillion-dollar plus, you know, system. And it's so interesting because actually a lot of its product is actually just fueled back into itself. So it's this self-organized entity, and it's based on, again, you know, fossil fuels. But part of it, its subsector, is what is known as fine chemicals, which are then fed in as sort of feedstock into the pharmaceutical industry. And then those chemicals are tested and they're targeted to basically disrupt certain processes in the body, i.e. poison. And some of them say if it causes a sleepy side effect, are then remarketed as having a therapeutic effect for sleep, even though on average there are at least 75 documented adverse health effects per chemical. So the whole notion that somehow this is medicine or somehow related to stimulating self-healing is really quite sad, because it's not about that. In fact, most of the common medical practice today is suppressing chemical poisoning with further chemicals. So the overarching theme is that we are, you know, living in a completely new phase of human evolution or devolution, which is that we are now, you know, slathing chemicals all over ourselves, taking them therapeutically. Every aspect of our life now is filled with them. And that's why I believe your summit is so important, Deanna, because, you know, for some time myself, I've been thinking about why isn't someone focusing on this particular issue? It's so important. So what we want to do, of course, is reveal the problem in, you know, high relief. And it's rather disarming and disillusioning. But it doesn't have to be disempowering, because a lot of my own work is finding that research that shows we can use foods and probiotics and certain types of, you know, spiritual practices to overcome what almost appears like a post-apocalyptic situation. You know, you can't take back radioisotopes that are released into our environment. You know, plutonium has like a half-life of 24,000 years. In fact, uranium-238, which is one of the fallouts from, you know, basic, nuclear power industries, as well as Chernobyl and Fukushima, has a half-life as old as this Earth. So you can't recall back these. And then you have biopollution with genetic manipulation, which is, you know, irrevocable. And so you have this situation where we can't undo what we've done, and yet we're holding together. The miracle is that we are still whole and alive, and most of us are almost healthy still. It's just amazing in that respect. So that speaks to something really beautiful about the fact, you know, that we are constructed in this way. And as you know, of course, because your focus is so scientific and spiritual, you know, so I'm sure you could add to that.
I don't know if I can add anything to the beauty of what you just said and really unravel to all of us. And what I'm picking up is really this message of hope and inspiration. So really understanding and being realistic about the facts, but then realizing that we can do something about it. I think before we get into the area of moving into doing something about it, I would like to take with you, if I could, a little bit of a philosophical journey into the past, you know, because we can learn so much about history or about the future from history, right? So if we kind of look back, what do you think, Sayer, is part of the reason, like, how did we get to this place of being so toxic? You know, what was it? What were kind of the linchpins? And what was it throughout our evolution and throughout our society? And what was happening? How did we get to this point in the 21st century that now we have to have a summit focused on toxicity? what do you think here?
What an amazing question. Well, you know, I would almost say like our modern situation is being caused by, you know, things like yoga deficiency, right? You know, I mean, I really like think like when it comes to cancer, it's deficiency of vegetables and fruits, right? And of course, it's much more complex. But really, that loss of connectedness to just the earth itself has developed into, you know, sort of a mass insanity when it comes to our relationship to our bodies and our world. You know, the most sacred of all things is water. It's, you know, the primary constituent of our body, and the way we treat the environment and the amount of poisons we're pouring in daily is just so unconscionable. So yeah, it's such a profound question you're asking. I have to say though, I'm always amazed that when I think about the detoxification systems that our body was pre-constructed to have previous to the Industrial Revolution, which is, you know, around the 1890s is when it all really began, and we started to produce literally billions of new novel chemical compounds. And somehow our body was preordained and pre-constructed to have the cytochrome P450 enzyme systems that are capable of breaking down and eliminating primarily these chemicals that didn't even exist when those mechanisms evolved over millions of years. So I just don't know exactly what that means, but it's very encouraging in certain respects that in many ways this is a phase we're going through that's almost you know, it was already designed to be that way. But I guess it's about really rediscovering ancient healing technologies and the power of the body, as well as using the science to, in ways, confirm and further amplify those powers that are sort of built within us. But the question is so profound, I would have to spend a few days just thinking about it to have a, you know, articulate answer.
Well, I think you gave a very articulate response, and it really does make me think of probably what our listeners have in mind, which is, you know, you mentioned that through evolution and through the times that we've evolved with these enzymes that we have in our bodies in order to cope with these toxins. And many people say, well, we don't need to detoxify because our bodies already have these systems in place. So how do you address that? Do you think that you've been alluding to the fact that our bodies are very resilient, they're very adaptable? So don't you think that we're doing fairly well? Like you mentioned, we're surviving, and most of us, or some of us, are pretty healthy. So do you think we're okay with the detoxification systems that we have in our bodies currently?
That's the best question you could have asked. Exactly. I mean, this is the fundamental fatal flaw of conventional toxicology, which is the assumption that our body is sort of like a biofilter and that the dose makes the poison. So the old model was completely ignorant of things like endocrine disruption, where the lower the concentration of a chemical compound, the higher its ability to disrupt and or mimic a hormone. And this is something we've recently found with glyphosate, which is the primary constituent of Roundup herbicide, is that in the parts per trillion concentration range, it exhibits an estrogenic, carcinogenic, you know, property that wouldn't be present if there was a higher concentration, which would just strictly be cytotoxic. It would just kill. The same is true for our discovery of low-dose radioisotope accumulation in the body, is that the old risk model was based on really atomic bomb blast survivors, where, you know, there's an external dose of gamma radiation across a certain amount of tissue. And they're finding that very low amounts of uranium-238, which is used in depleted uranium munitions now, et cetera. There's dust all over the world because of it. Or plutonium, just one little plutonium atom is enough to cause cancer because of its ability to, there's a number of mechanisms that they've identified, but the idea is that there's exponentially greater toxicity associated with either a lower particle size, so this applies to nanotechnology as well. Take nanoparticle titanium dioxide in sunscreen, and it's far more harmful because it can get right through the pores and start actually activating nuclear programs within the cell. And then, of course, again, endocrine disruptors, which are primarily petrochemical-based, BPA, et cetera, as well as, of course, the radioisotopes. So, and again, all of our risk assessments were based on the concept that you had to take animals, kill 50% with a chemical, and then from there you deduce an acceptable level of harm for humans based on the body weight difference. So because we didn't see all these dead bodies around us, we assumed that all of these chemicals were safe, release them into the environment, put them in your food. And now, you know, half a century or more later, we're discovering that this epidemic of disease, especially things like cancer, is really being caused by these chemicals. So yes, that question is so important. The old model of toxicology has been completely been disproven and needs to be revised in favor of the precautionary principle, which, as we talked about earlier, really is the return of the principle of no injury, or sort of almost a Buddhist concept, back into, you know, this system.
Well said. That, again, I really like to wax philosophic with you here, because there's so many angles we can go after. I guess something that came to mind for me as I was just listening to you was, if it's really about a low dose can have such an exorbitant effect, and in some worlds we call that a xenohormetic effect, right, where it's, you know, just a small amount has an amplified effect. So I'm just curious, so why doesn't everybody get cancer then? Or why don't we all get some kind of chronic disease pretty early on? I mean, because it sounds like so many things that we are encountering in our environment, I mean, we can't really go a day really without having this kind of exposure, right?
Yes.
So we'll talk about what we can do about it. But I'm just curious, why don't we all form some type of chronic disease, you know, much earlier on? Why aren't we all getting cancer?
You know, I like, you know, Andrew Lloyd Wright, he said something like, I believe in God, but I call it nature, is that that's the proof of God, or of this infinite intelligence and benevolence, because there's no reason why, knowing what we know, that we should all even be feeling a semblance of our own humanity in certain respects, like being even conscious, because it's that omnipresent. I mean, the air and rain samples recently performed in the Midwest showed that most contain glyphosate in physiologically relevant conditions. Like, you can't even escape it. We're breathing it in daily. If you were doing assays of our teeth, you'd find all types of uranium or plutonium signatures from, you know, nuclear weapons testing. So that is a great question, because I guess, like, when I started to look more into this issue, like, okay, I focus on indexing research on the adverse effects of bisphenol and, you know, even radioisotopes, and you find the studies that show, like, post-Chernobyl, they took apple pectin, and they saved literally hundreds of thousands of children from certain accelerated premature death because of its ability to basically pull out those radioisotopes. Or taking kimchi bacteria, you know, the beneficial bacteria, and showing that it can break down these persistent organic pollutant pesticides, which our own bodies don't have the genetic or enzyme capability to do. So as we become more familiar with symbiosis and this network of, you know, trillions of cells that, you know, constitute our meta-organism, we're starting to understand how powerful, you know, these natural processes are, and how they protect us on a moment-to-moment basis. So, yeah, it's a really good question.
Well, you know, one of the things that you just mentioned there, and me being a nutrition professional, hearing you say things like kimchi and apple pectin can do things that maybe our body can't do so efficiently, are you suggesting that we might be able to, part of the solution might come from food?
Yes. I mean, food to me is the most sacred of all words on some level, because we are food, and food is life, and it's also a profoundly dense source of information, which is something that I think is overlooked. So when you do things to food, like irradiate it with ionizing radiation, you've destroyed such a complex set of packets of information upon which our genetic and, you know, epigenetic infrastructure depend. So when we start understanding what food really is, and that it's life in that respect, then yes, that is actually the answer, is that there's not a single cell in the body. This is Andrew Saul said this, that is composed of a chemical. So why would we even think to expose ourselves or intentionally take a, quote, therapeutic chemical or put it in our food or inject it into our bodies, knowing that fundamental fact? You know, and we're in a unique situation, you know, in a way it's sort of, you know, post-apocalyptic, in the sense of, is there really anything called organic anymore. You know, like our bodies are so part of the environment. There's no difference, is that we can't do anything out there that isn't going to directly affect our bodies. So, you know, it's really important that we reconnect to the meaning of food and know where it comes from and understand soil quality and all the connected factors, for sure.
So I'm curious about what you eat and how you take precautions in the way of food in order to ensure that you're reducing your toxin load. So can you give the listeners some ideas as to what they could do in their everyday life with food? Maybe some things that you currently do, since you're such a walk the talk person, right? You are right there in it, very authentic. So I'm sure that you've adopted practices with food that have been very beneficial.
Yeah, I actually recently started to re-explore sort of intermittent fasting. And I think there could be a gendered aspect to this, almost a little chauvinistic. And I'm type O blood, if it's relevant. There are certain things about my diet now, which I like to start my day off really by doing exercise. And I find that if I'm using, like, say, good quality fats, coconut oil, for example, I think my metabolism has really flipped towards, you know, using fats as a primary fuel source. It's consistent with certain approaches out there. Dr. Mercola, also someone I work with, who has given me some really good information that I've employed that has been helpful to me. But I do try to balance that out with very high quality, as far as I can assure, high nutrient, low carbohydrate. You know, it sounds ridiculous. Yeah, like things like kale and, you know, eating a whole avocado when I'm hungry. I don't try to eat, you know, the sort of standard formulaic sandwich or like pasta with something. I just stay away from that generally. But I also allow for that experience, assuming it's gluten-free, because I'm pretty strict about that. Because when you start to get orthorexic and you have this sort of like poisoning of the experience, the very real nocebo effect, like if you think something's bad for you, it actually generates a cortisol elevation, which has a series of deleterious health effects. You know, it even will cause an elevation of blood sugar, gluconeogenesis on the liver, all the things you don't want by eating carbohydrates. So like, people do project their fears of mortality into their food, because it's one of the only things we can control, you know, like is what we're eating or not eating. And in fact, even their religious issues and aspirations get projected into their food, as you know, better than anyone, I'm sure. But, you know, I do try to eat like one meal that's very, you know, sort of standard meal. But I'm fortunate because in Southwest Florida, we have a 100% organic restaurant called Food and Thought. It's also a store, and they have like a raw meal that they make that tastes amazing. And they, you know, they do all organic. So as far as organic can protect me, I hope that helps.
Oh, no, that's great. Well, I was hoping you could take us a little bit even more into your day. So what is this? You know, are there certain things that you make sure that you eat every day, or just, you know, give us a little bit of more of a lens into, you know, a say or day and you're waking up, what are you eating for breakfast? What are you eating for lunch? If you're doing intermittent fasting, is, you know, is that 12 hours overnight, or just tell us a little bit about what you do in that way?
Generally, I wake and I have coffee with honey. And I know that some are not big fans of coffee, but I am. And I, you know, maybe I have a little bit of a bias. I've collected a lot of research on its health benefits, and I'm sort of an advocate of Paul Schulich's perspective on coffee. You know, it is a fermented food and it's powerful antioxidant, and one of the few things in the Western dietary configuration that has bitter, you know, that we appreciate. So that is something I start off. And then I usually do some type of workout. I'm fortunate enough to live on the Gulf, so I can actually go run on the beach. I had a barefoot running experience this morning with a dolphin there too, which was just amazing. So, yeah, I know. It's just so, it's a blessed life right now. But we also have the terrible red tide that can accost you at any minute. So then I come back and I usually have, believe it or not, I do a little whey isolate right after the workout just to make sure I can continue on my day without muscle soreness, no casein in it. And then what do I do? I often, again, I don't know how healthy this sounds. I don't eat often until maybe, you know, 12 or 1, I'll have like macadamia nuts or avocado or a green drink of some type. So right now, food hasn't really been so much my focus as just, you know, yoga and running and things like that.
Well, maybe you can talk about that too, because there are many ways to detox, right? And so one of them is through sweat. is through activity and getting that circulation and the lymphatics moving. And I'd also like for you to talk about yoga and your practice there, and perhaps more of even the spiritual approach and looking at all of the other aspects of toxins. So, you know, are these just physical toxins, or can we also take in psychological toxins? How do we get rid of those?
Yeah, really good question. Well, I love the fact you brought up sweating, because I'm a big advocate of trying to induce a really profuse sweat as often as possible, partially because of new research that surfaced just actually in 2011 that proved that even though if you did like a blood serum assay of your heavy metal levels or even tissue, you won't always find that you have high levels. But what they did is they induced sweating, and they measured the sweat and found significantly elevated levels of petroleum byproducts and things like mercury and cadmium being excreted in high amounts. So it confirms what we kind of already know, which is that sweating is a very effective way to eliminate a lot of these compounds. So I really do aspire to do that, but I also try to infuse my diet with things like Himalayan sea salt and, you know, really mineral rich foods. Otherwise you can kind of get into trouble there. So sweating, and then of course the lymphatic system doesn't really have a pump like the heart, you know, pumps your blood. So when you're doing sweating, you're also really getting your lymphatic system moving, which is extremely important as far as things like, you know, immune health as well as cancer prevention. So, you know, that's a big part of it. But when it comes to yoga, I mean, actually, I took a significant break from it and only recently returned to it. And, you know, for me, because I do really love the feeling I get from intense workouts, from CrossFit to group power to spin, I just recently realized how sacred yoga is for all levels, you know, especially things like power vinyasa. I just really love what it does and the strength that one has to have from the inside out in order to you really be in those poses is just remarkable. And as a yoga practitioner yourself, I'm sure you could shed light on that as well, of course. So.
No, that's beautiful. And yoga is such a great way to meld together the body, mind, and spirit. And so through that practice, we might be able to really reconcile and use the body to deal with a lot of these psychological toxins too that we might be feeling, right?
Yes.
So what do you do if you're having a bad day and there's just, I know that you're living within this aura of goodness with Green Medicine Info and, you know, just doing all this great work, but do you ever have a day where you just feel like, you know, maybe there was a little bit of a toxic exchange or toxic people, or, you know, I'm sure that, you know, you might come across those situations, maybe infrequent, but, you know, what do you do with that? What do you do with that information? How do you process it? How do you detoxify from those things?
That's a great question. I mean, certainly it's happens quite often, and I largely take responsibility for it in certain ways. Obviously my emotions in response to those sorts of situations, but just being aware of it and letting it be and try not to repeat, you know, contribute to repeating, that really makes a huge difference. Because, you know, with the discovery of the nocebo effect, which really means I do harm, and it's in the context of clinical medicine, you know, the placebo is I will help or I will heal, is that the attitude one has towards one another or oneself is directly connected to our physiology in a very measurable way. So that if, for example, a study was published in the New England Journal of Medicine just now, it's 2 years ago, but it showed that when a cancer diagnosis was being made, if that person had a positive diagnosis that you have cancer, they had up to 26.9-fold increased risk of death within the first week from heart-related causes. And it was directly correlated to the type of cancer. So if it was brain cancer, hard to treat, then it was like the worst. But so to see that and to know that your thoughts or someone else's thoughts that you trust in authority has that kind of power over us to even kill you within 1 week is so important for people to understand. So, you know, I think that's where the future of nutrition really lies, is also just acknowledging how important it is to really appreciate you know, the experience of food as well, you know, as well as just the strictly the composition of it. It's a very double-edged sword, but you know, I think that's why your project intrigues me so much, because I want those answers too. I want to know where it coincides and how we can navigate these two poles, which seem opposite, but yet they're so essential, both of them.
Well, you're very familiar with the science. Are you seeing more studies on things like spirituality and how spiritual practices or religion or, you know, a belief system can really influence somebody's health? Because I believe even when I read The Blue Zones by Dan Buettner, he talked about we have to have a sense of purpose, that really is a marker of longevity. So do you subscribe to this, or do you think that there's anything to these types of beliefs that we carry?
Absolutely. Yeah. There's been research on meditation and yoga on enhancing either the enzyme telomerase, which is what heals up the ends of our chromosomes. So when cells divide as they have to through life to repair and replenish the damaged cells, if that, you know, end of those chromosomes gets cut into every time, eventually you're going to cut into code that's important and it'll cause mutations and the cell will die or have cancer or disease. So telomerase heals those ends up, so you can do that many more times into the future. So it's interesting how now we can measure on a molecular level, genetically, you know, that these practices, which are sort of top down, you know, spirit, mind, body, have a direct effect on these, you know, unquestionably, we know now that, yes, you can take back your destiny even without having to even focus neurotically on what you're putting into your mouth. Although that is essential as well. So yeah, I think the science is really starting to confirm, but there's also the reality that the evidence-based medical model is so myopic in certain ways. And when there's a null finding, it doesn't mean that it's not true. And that's the assumption is, oh, we didn't prove that it's true, so therefore it's not real. So I think that's another severe limit, is that science has become, in many ways, the ultimate religion that attempts to devour all others. You know, and it's just not the case. So there's so many ways to experience life, even through your senses. You don't need the intermediary of, you know, peer-reviewed published research to do that.
Well, you know, and we're both scientists, right? So for you to say something like that is very profound, that you're flexible about your views on science, but yet appreciate it and see it as a wonderful tool. So, and I know that for many people, until we have science on certain things, they're not going to really adhere to anything or try a modality. So it's almost like, you know, a dog chasing its tail, that we can't really initiate something until we have the proof, but we can't get the proof until we actually can, you know, get somebody to be invested in the idea.
You got it. Yeah.
So, it's nice to hear that you really have a very overarching embrace and a good mindset, I think, around how to perceive all of this scientific data that you deal with on a day-to-day basis. You know, you have a very balanced approach, which is very refreshing.
Thank you.
So, you mentioned so many things, Sayer, in terms of Roundup and GMOs and chemicals and macadamia nuts. There's so many things here that we could, again, mine. I think one of the things that our listeners are very concerned about, and I know that you have a lot of your efforts directed here, is towards GMOs. And we're going to be speaking with other experts on this area, but I'm curious if you can share with us perhaps some strategies. You know, people ask me this all the time. Are they protected against eating GMOs if they buy organically grown food? What is their way to protect themselves from GMOs?
Wow, what a great question. Well, I'd like to say that, yes, we can protect ourselves from the contamination with GMO products or the agrochemical fallout from the system. But the reality is that here, even in Florida, you know, there's some organic farming going on where you can technically legally take, you know, Purdue chicken manure and use that as your fertilizer. So if you just look at the microbiome issue there, which is profound, meaning, you know, the existence of antibiotic resistant bacteria, and then you realize that they're fed GMO corn, and then some of those proteins and compounds are being fed back into the plants, and they don't biodegrade in there all the time. The situation is truly unconscionable and extremely sad. So the USDA organic certifications, unfortunately, no longer hold as much value, if any, in certain cases. Like, there's a USDA organic formula on the market, which is sold in natural product stores that has, you know, a pesticide in it, which is cupric sulfate, you know, and so that's okay to call it USDA organic, and yet it's a pesticide in it. You know, it's no wonder we have one of the highest infant mortality rates, you know, in the world. So unfortunately, there is a big issue with that. Now, ultimately, the real solution will be when we start locally growing our food again, because again, the organic certifications support a globalized food system where you're still taking, you know, fossil fuel or nuclear energy derived food calories to deliver, you know, let's say 1 calorie of organic carrots from the West Coast to the East Coast with 50 calories of fossil fuel and nuclear energy. So that's so unsustainable and so unhealthy to the planet as a whole, so that if you feel you're hermetically sealed, you can afford to buy your organic fruit at Whole Foods and it doesn't matter. It's just not true anymore, you know? So, and then there's a problem with like jet fuel contaminating a lot of the organic produce because it just bioaccumulates there. So everything, unfortunately, well, it's fortunate that we know this is linked now, and we can't just pretend like we're protected by the label anymore. So, but we do need it. It's better to know that it wasn't explicitly poisoned, explicitly irradiated. It's just, you know, not the same anymore.
So what my takeaways are from what you just said is, if you can, grow your own food as best you can, you know, depending on where you live and your circumstances. But even if it's a windowsill herb garden, perhaps, you know, starting there and really small. And then secondly, that organic would be the higher choice. It may not be deliberately contaminated, but it may have things just by way of distribution. So we just do our best there.
Yeah. And then also biodynamic is really the most spiritual of all forms of farming. And, you know, it's almost like a calorie in to the land and a calorie point, maybe one or two out, you know, which is really the whole nature of the universe, is to create abundance out of practically nothing. And so once we realize that free energy is available on all levels, you know, especially with our food, it's like with yoga and all the things you're trying to connect or are connecting, is that's really the future, I think, is understanding that.
Can you explain biodynamic? Because I don't think that many people, when I lived in Europe, there was a pretty good understanding of that there. But I don't think that many Americans, North Americans, maybe other pockets of the world really have a good understanding of what biodynamic is. So maybe you can just give us a kind of a snapshot of what that means exactly. How can we grow biodynamic food?
Well, the idea too is you don't have any type of, let's say, input of energy into the land you're growing your food that was maybe from, like, say, a tractor that's driven by fossil fuel. Or you do things like you take an old growth tree, take some of the soil underneath it and put it into the soil through a horn, like say a ram's horn, and it inoculates that soil. And this is before a lot of the discoveries of microbiology, but just they'll use amethyst powder to, you know, amplify the light energy, but there's probably other aspects to what's happening that, you know, we don't fully understand. But it's part of, you know, the sort of Rudolf Steiner tradition. I'm certainly not an expert in it, but it's definitely way beyond organic. And you'll see Demeter certified products now. So you'll know, and a lot of this happens like in New Zealand, wherever. But that's really, I think, where we need to move. And there are at least models out there, permaculture as well, which, you know, really honor that ancient way of getting the land to produce sustainably, you know, with that abundance. So,
you know, you're saying a number of things there that is leading me down a different train of thought of wondering whether or not all this toxicity is because we're out of alignment with the planet. And when we're out of alignment and we're not connected to the planet, and we start to impose our own chemicals, then we have repercussions. We have health effects. We have where we need to start talking about detox. Yes. So it's almost like we just came full circle into what we started off talking about, you know, how did we get here? And now how do we get back to where we were? And maybe it has something to do with being in proper connection with nature.
Yes.
And so doing that, you know, how do we just do that? Because many people are busy professionals. They have busy lives. They're juggling families. Maybe they're in school. You know, I'm just seeing so many people really stressed. And so it's almost like, you know, we have the universe of our individual self, then we have the macrocosm of everything we're connected to. So how do we even begin to create this healing salve of coming into communion again with all of nature and really feeling that sense of interconnection through the web. How do we get there?
Well, you know, one of the best, more practical approaches I would consider taking, and this is something I've done in the past, is sometimes you just literally take a break from what you're eating on a daily basis and do things like do a mono diet of just organic apples. You'll never, I mean, depending on your, you know, your climb, if it's, you know, your higher latitude, it's winter, it might not be a good idea, but that is better than just, say, going through a heroic herbal detox, you know, where the assumption is you're just going to use these potent herbs to stimulate quickly elimination. And some of the more high-tech interventions, even like chelation therapy, although they have value, you could accomplish many of the same effects through pomegranate and other things that have been now tested. So, but the idea is you're giving your body, sometimes for the first time in your life, a break from having to digest something that has been cooked or processed, just kind of like the sludgy like stuff we call food, and the vibrant, beautiful energy of one of nature's most perfect whole foods with structured, you know, water, dissolved oxygen, pectins, just living like life force in it will not only nourish you, because you really, again, will never be hungry. You just eat another apple 30 minutes from then if you really are. And then it will also provide the detoxification elements. That's kind of what I meant by radical nourishment. That's sort of detox, retox, this sort of, really, we can get back to using our foods as a way to nourish and detoxify us at the same moment. A lot of the soluble fibers and things like, you know, steamed kale, for example, will just gently suction out that gallbladder, help to pull the toxins the liver's not effectively removing. You know, that's, and the thing too about the microbiome is, like, if you're getting food from the soil that's healthy, it'll have shot through it all of these amazing bacteria. You chop up cabbage, throw it in a mason jar, leave it there for a few days. Each tablespoon, in theory, could have a trillion or more colony-forming units. And so really understanding that it's all there for us already, but we want to get back to more pristine kind of healing food protocol. And again, it's going to be individualized for everyone, but I do think it's important to start thinking of skipping meals, developing some emptiness and hunger, and then reintroducing a whole food that has, you know, just a lot of power, avocado, apples, you know, things like that.
That sounds beautiful. It's simple enough where people could do it, and it's sustainable too. So say, or to kind of come to a close, because we talked about so many things, very philosophical, very scientific, even spiritual. What would you say would be, if you could just distill everything into three essential bullet points or takeaways, what would you want people to remember based on everything that we talked about? What is most important for them to have top of mind as they continue to move forward now, learning about toxins, going through the process of detoxification, and then preventing retoxification, right? So how do we stay in that mode? What would be your top, what are Sayer's top three tips?
Well, top tip is that basically the number one problem is what we're exposed to. So when we look at our diet, I would definitely encourage people to go back in time to really where our body still is. You know, we live in a sort of post-agrarian, you know, society where we just don't even think about eating grains. It's normal. We feed them to our animals. We eat the animals or their milk. And I would like people to go back in time to where that didn't even exist, so that we can eliminate, because toxicity really starts, I think, with foods that are biologically incompatible. And, you know, once you remove those foods, it leaves this amazing place open for the truly healing vegetables and fruits and that whole rainbow of colors, which all of which are so essential for our healing. Like when you look at, say, an apple or a tomato or kale, you're dealing with tens of thousands of compounds, and you're dealing with an energy state that's also an information state, which will bathe our genes in the information needed. Because in the field of epigenetics, now we know the center of sort of, you know, how we maintain our health is not within the gene itself. You know, every cell has the same genome, and they're all different, doing different things. It's actually the environment, which in the case of nutrition is really the foods we're bathing ourselves in, that are going to determine our health and for the most part. So that's number one, is go back in time to not necessarily paleo as an Orthodox system, but similar to whole foods-based things that you aren't cooking as much, although cooking does have value, and I would defer to Ayurvedic sort of teachings with that. Number two would be really as a tip, exercise, because I really feel like when we eat, most of us get to this point of saturating our bodies with nutrition. And a lot of it's just carbohydrate, like the starch-like glycogen in our cells. It just builds up. You have about 8 hours, I think, approximately, of storage glycogen, and then the rest gets turned into things that our body doesn't need, you know? And so when we exercise, we're getting that energy, we're expending it, we're leaving room for the cells to pull in not only those basic nutrients like glucose, but all the cofactors that we need to be healthy. So it's also essential for our detoxification, as we talked about, and not just physically, but emotionally. The amount of beautiful, powerful neurochemicals released, I mean, gives like oxycodone and chocolate and all those things a run for their money. Prozac, when you get that, the juice is flowing, and it doesn't have to be just through running. It could be through things like yoga. You know, then we have finally gotten back to that baseline of being able to rebuild ourselves, you know, and then remembering that every, you know, molecule in our body really does come through what we are or are not eating. And that is such a powerful fact, is that, you know, every 3 days, the intestinal lining completely regenerated. The average age of a human body based on carbon-14 testing, which is actually nuclear fallout related, is about 10 to 14 years. There's only a few cells in our body that are there forever, which is like the brain cells behind our eye, which is so interesting. But generally, we have the ability to regenerate the entire infrastructure of our body over the course of just a decade. And it's going to depend on what we are or are not eating. So, and then I guess lastly, this is number four, it's just the acknowledging the miracle that we all are still here functioning given what has occurred to our planet. And that is really our power, and realizing that 99.9% of our health is really based on the self-healing energy that's constantly unfolding, and really realizing too, the biggest enemy of that is our mind, not knowing that, projecting all of the power of healing onto an authority outside of us. And really we need to project it back into where it is, which is nature, which is what we are, you know? So we have to treat our environment and our planet as the most sacred of all things, you know? So that's really my whole thing.
That was amazing. Sayer, you have taken us into a scientific and sacred detoxification process. I love everything that you just said. Very useful tips for everybody. What a contribution. So thank you so much for being part of the Detox Summit. It's really been a pleasure to have you.
Thank you. It's been completely my honor. So you're doing great things. Appreciate it.